Real quick, before I begin, here's a list of people who asked. Okay, wonderful. Let's get on with the video.
This video is brought to you by PIA, Private Internet Access. Over the last two decades, it's no secret that technology has bloomed. There's a lot to have to understand, but nothing more important than online security. Anything you do online on an unprotected device can be viewed by any number of unintended entities before it reaches its destination. With over 30 million downloads, PIA is the world's most transparent VPN provider, and also one of the highest rated, with an excellent rating on Trustpilot with over 8,500 reviews. PIA has also rolled out a new feature, and you can now use PIA on an unlimited number of devices, which is kind of a game changer when you think about that. PIA protects you from the prying eyes of any unwanted parties who should not be helping themselves to your personal data by hiding your IP address and safeguarding your connection via an encrypted tunnel. But also allows you to view region-restricted content from all over the world. Netflix, Amazon Prime, Disney Plus, geo-locked sports events, and even online deals are in the palm of your hand with PIA. Watching a streaming service without having PIA is being allowed to go to a world buffet, and only being allowed to eat the croutons whilst you watch everybody else tuck in to the amazing food. And that sucks, except the world buffet is Amazon Prime, and the 2004 Grudge was not available in my location. For some reason. Setup only takes a few minutes. The install is hilariously simple. It's ludicrous. With an extremely slick and easy to understand UI. And you guys know how much of a sucker I am for UI. And I love that it tells you the ping that you can expect before accessing a server too. I know it's a small thing, but for me it saves so much like jumping around. So save yourself the hassle. With the link in the description or in the pinned comment, save 83% on PIA for just $2.03 per month and 4 months free. So, let's get back to the video.
Alright, girls, boys, and chips ahoys, Nier Automata. I first discovered Nier Automobile hilariously on an International Women's Day display in the PlayStation Store a good 3 or 4 years ago. I can hardly remember now, but what I do remember about the display is that I saw characters like Aloy, Lara Croft, and Jill Valentine all presented besides their respective titles, but there was one game that I didn't recognise, Nier Automata. I gave the front cover a good look. I was intrigued. I love anime as an art style, even though most anime tropes drive me up the wall. I thought the little guy looked a bit plain, but I loved the woman, who I would soon learn was 2B. Her whole vibe, the black and white motif, the sleek black dress, her obvious framing as the main character, the blindfold was mysterious. She was cool. I didn't buy it straight away, for whatever reason, but I tucked it into the back of my mind where I keep the names of dirty videos I like but feel too ashamed to bookmark, and kept an eye out for it should it ever go on sale. I was very intrigued, and I didn't have to wait long. Very kindly, my friend Shrey gifted me a copy. I was excited and very grateful.
This was a combat-focused game with light RPG elements and a really cool main character and apparently a sci-fi and philosophy-heavy story set in a post-apocalyptic dystopia. Do you understand how perfect a game that is for me? I love all of those things. They are my favorite things. It's like they were looking over my shoulder when I was browsing incognito. These guys really raked through my search history for this one. Unfortunately, it didn't take me long to completely changed my mind on this game. I'm sorry, Shrey.
Despite usually disliking anime RPGs, I tried very fiercely to get into Nier Automata. A notorious cutscene skipper, I forced myself to diligently sit and let each one play, remarking on my general observations to my Twitch chat about the context, the world's history, and the characters and their motivations. I did all of the side quests as they popped up, not only to level and get good loot, but also just to get an idea of the world I was in, give myself even more context, and bond with 2B as a main character for a little bit. I made a real effort with this game. Unfortunately, it's pants. I was so frustrated by my inability to get it that I ended up talking to a guy at work called Ed, who I knew was a massive fan of the game. I knew it was one of his favourite games ever. I went and quizzed him about his favourite moments, hoping for some tips or general advice so I could experience less friction with the game. As far as I remember, the conversation went something like this.
Hello, Ed. What do you like about Nier Automata? Was it 2B's arse? Yeah.
So, I guess it was. Now, before we get started, please drop a like, comment your own thoughts on Nier Automata, and subscribe for more content. I cover games and TV as often as I humanly can, so stick around for more. Furthermore, check out my Patreon in the link below. I put out 5-minute reviews every Tuesday at 4 p.m. UK time, with occasional bonus reviews on Saturdays. Patrons also get access to videos early, sometimes up to a month early, and extra content that I put out as often as I can. Special thanks to my patrons for making this video happen. This was a Patreon goal, with an extra special thanks to Brendan, Brody Cullen, Duck, Julia, Carissa Fulcher, and Sam Jones for being my highest tier patrons. Now, let's get started.
Now, before we get to the bad-mouthing, let's acknowledge some of the stuff that I did really enjoy.
One of the things I appreciate most about Nier Automata is the gameplay. The game starts with a bullet hell sequence that evolves in bits and pieces throughout all three of the playthroughs. It will make sense later, trust me. And what I really appreciated about the combat specifically is that enemies fire two different kinds of projectiles. Some can only be destroyed with bullets, and some can only be destroyed in melee. So this means that not only do you have to be keeping a watchful eye on your surroundings and killing enemies as they spawn, but you also need to be flicking back and forth mentally between melee and range, which adds an additional layer of priority to the mental load of combat. Not only that, but Nier feels fun to, like, fundamentally move in. 2B runs very fast and has superhuman jumping abilities, which means you're never slowly parkouring around, you just leap and swoop, which means that running from one end of the map to the other is not an unpleasant experience. I think this enjoyable movement is something a lot of games struggle to get right, and teleportation is added a little way into the game, adding an extra travel option, which I really respect.
A lot of games, such as like Dying Light, don't offer any kind of fast travel because they're like, moving around is the experience. But sometimes, even if you really like the movement, you just need to pop over somewhere real quickly. You got a side quest to do and you really can't be arsed because it's like, find 5 flowers. And it becomes more of an inconvenience to go over and grab there. Like, a fast travel is sometimes just a nice option to have. I think it's a really smug attitude for a game to have to assume that you are perfectly happy to retread the same area 80 times for these optional little bits of quest that are just so not worth it. I enormously respect Nier Automata for allowing players the freedom of choice and not burdening them with the assumption that the game is intended to be experienced on these very stringent, self-indulgent terms. It respects your time in this way, you know? Thank you, Nier.
The game has auto-aim options as well, which, like in a lot of games, can be finicky in areas, but largely worked really well. I didn't have many issues with any sticky auto-aim. This is especially useful in the areas that flip very seamlessly between 2D and 3D, adding additional dimensions to locales that sincerely needed even the smallest bit of sprucing up. I'll get onto this later, but I felt like so much creative opportunity was missed with the locations of this game. Having the camera flip around you, turning sections into platformers and flip-flopping between dimensions, zooming in and out to show the breadth of massive areas that would feel ineffably straight and unimaginative otherwise, is a really simple way of just adding a bit of spice to the game. If not for that, it would have been even worse. The Castle of the Forest King, for example, is super boring. It's composed of almost entirely identical adjoining rooms with no visual dressing beyond the wall hangings and stairs. You run along the bottom from left to right, climb to the top, then run along from right to left. Then there's an interesting room that you have a short boss fight in, and for a place that could have been spectacle, it's like a place in your house you have no idea what to do with, so you just put some basic fake IKEA plant in the corner and call it a day, so having this flip into 2D was really welcome. I liked the music too, on the whole. A lot of people tout the music in this game as the second coming of Christ, and I don't quite see it, but I do still like it. Some of the songs with heavy vocals make me cringe in a way that I couldn't explain. There's one part during the story where you're in an exploding factory, and the music just is really cringe, I don't know. I felt so embarrassed that I rushed out of there as fast as I could just to make the music end. But my favourite theme was the theme park theme. I think it cultivates an air of eerie intrigue and fascination. It's creepy in a beautiful way, I love it. Beyond that, there are a lot of battle themes that are sick, and the Machine Village theme is really lovely. Most of it is fairly standard action music, but there's a great inclusion of violins or some kind of stringed apparatus, I don't know music very well, that added a unique flair to the score. Finally, I liked, to a point, the relationship 2B had with her pod, the little drone that follows her around. A lot of anime RPGs have a companion character whose job it is to dispense exposition constantly, no matter how much you need to hear it, often to the point of stopping a game short just to bleat obvious facts at you about the action you're normally already in the process of trying to do. Like you're literally winding up to smack an enemy before you're stopped and told over the course of 3 minutes that you need to smack the enemy. Nia mocks this trope in a way that actually feels very cathartic, but also leans into 2B's characterization as a seasoned fighter. During the tutorial, the pod will point out facts that are useful to us, but 2B will already know, and thankfully doesn't pause the game to do so, such as pointing out enemies are armored or to notify us that ranged attacks work better in certain encounters, and it's a tidbit for us that works, but for 2B it's old news, so she'll just flatly go, yes, I know. I don't know, after years of Navi and Ishun panting down my ear hole, it was a welcome break to hear someone equally unimpressed with this backseating as I was. It doesn't exactly negate the fact that the drone is stating the obvious, but it's appreciated in a cathartic way and it fits in with the tutorial as a whole. Now, onto the meat of this video.
Despite my general dislike of anime RPGs, I will admit that I have learned to expect visual excellence in even the worst of them. I thought, for example, that Code Vein was so crap that it actually inspired me to make this YouTube channel in the first place, because I just had to get that review out. I couldn't sit on my feelings about that game. But I still couldn't deny how fantastic it looked. It was really impressively visual. Every boss had been so uniquely and creatively designed. Many of them were some of the most incredible looking bosses I have ever fought in gaming. I think you could recognize even the minor enemies as being from Code Vein at a glance years after playing it. Every map is designed with very specific care, each one focused on different gimmicks that help them feel unique. Like, despite how universally hated the Anor Londo looking ripoff White Tower one was, I understood that it was intended to function as a confusing maze, even if it didn't quite stick the landing. Like, it's boring, and no amount of design decision is going to change that. There's a lot of spectacle in these kinds of titles, and anime RPGs, like for example the Final Fantasy VII Remake, have this really impressive ability to find beauty in anything, even the miserable.
So I have only myself to blame for my apparently unreasonable assumption that Nia, Wallace, and Grommeter would look good. When I first picked up the game, I worked my way through the tutorial segment, getting my little tips and tricks from the pod as I familiarized myself with the basic combat mechanics. And I remember vocalizing to my chat, these tutorial enemies look really boring, but I get what they're going for. The enemies in the tutorial look like combat mannequins, except rusty, I suppose. They're basic humanoid enemies, short, with simple movements and attacks. They're all brown, again, supposedly from rust, and there's not really much deviation from that besides height or armor. Their simplistic anatomy means it's easy to discern what they're doing, so they're good introductory enemies for a combat-focused game. I was like, ah, this is cool, so I'm in some kind of robot production facility where they make the workers. These designs are both to show the origins of what I'll see later, but also keep their shape simple so that I can just practice combat on them without having to get into anything complex. Function over fashion, respectable priorities. I was fairly impressed, and I was excited to see which enemies would await me once I breached the doors of the tutorial facility and got out into the big wide world. And it turns out that not much. Besides the occasional paint job or simple costume, these are the enemies you'll be fighting for pretty much the entire game. Bipedal enemies with the same attacks, doling out the same damage for 30 hours. Yeah, you know, they introduce taller enemies, enemies with shields, some enemies in hovercarts, occasionally enemies that have been built into drills, and some in what are essentially mech suits, but they're mostly just the same. Brown, rusted little dudes. And in a bit of a weird design choice, they're so small on screen when you're playing that I didn't realize they even have alternative looks, besides the amusement park ones, obviously, until I checked their designs online while writing this video. There are some deviations, such as ones that are spheres, like long centipedes, along with some anime characters you fight while they make speeches, but the vast majority of the enemies you fight will be almost identical in appearance. For a game with a focus on free-flowing combat, it definitely starts to get tired with any lack of fun visual variety. Even the bosses are unmemorable. Grey instead of brown. The most memorable one I fought was some naked person, and I think we can all understand why that was memorable. He later gets a twin, or a wife, if we're being biblical, and then they walk around in low-sitting leather chaps, which is somehow even weirder than their Ken doll nudity. The design of the boss you fight in the prologue is really cool. He's like a huge sentient oil rig, but he then becomes every fucking boss. I make fun of Neo for reusing bosses, but man, this team really did make one big enemy and call it a day, didn't they? I ended up so disappointed by the visuals of this game. Not only in terms of enemy variety either, even the locales were just bleak. And as I've said before, most anime RPGs I'm familiar with have an incredible ability to find beauty in misery. The crumbling cities of Code Vein, the districts of Final Fantasy VII, the caves of Okami. So in the case of it's bleak because it's supposed to be bleak, classic deflection, that doesn't really fly with me. Even Shadow of the Colossus, with its more realistic than stylized graphics, has mastered creating the feeling of a big, empty, dead open world while still cramming it full of intrigue. It's possible to have both the melancholy vibes and something worth exploring. Yet, Nier Auto Glass Repair, Auto Glass Replace takes us through some truly shit geographies. We have a standard crumbling city with copy-pasted buildings that seem like they can be explored, only for the player to discover that they are crammed full of invisible walls right at the point where a different game would have hidden an Easter egg or an item. We have an extremely washed out desert, we have a forest that looks like the Colors Run. The factory is at least dimensionally interesting, having you run around in there until the perspective starts zooming out. The beach with the pillars is okay, but is used solely to bookend an action sequence and then is never visited again. The place with the most potential is the amusement park, which is where I thought the visual design of this game would finally start to assert itself, especially during the location's boss encounter, which is by far the game's most impressive, both visually and story-wise. But then again, the amusement park was used to advertise the game at E3 prior to launch, so no wonder they put the most effort into it. It's really cool. The best boss in the game contained in an abandoned theme park alongside creepy machines. I was 100% on board and really excited to see where the game would steer me next. Except the problem with the theme park is that it's like a 10-minute segment that you never return to. It is so minor that I actually forgot about it until I wrote the script, at which point all the memories came flooding back. I really did think the eerie dark art style of the park would follow me from this point on, but we go right back to the washed out deserts and the washed out forests and that crap washed out city, and man, I've thought how much I missed the amusement park every step of the way. Washed out is really the key word with Nier. And ironic that the theme park is abandoned. Maybe it's a metaphor. The most interesting place you spend any extended time in is the little robot village in the treetops, but Pascal lives there, so we'll get to that. Everything about this game feels like someone's taken the saturation slider and cranked it right down. The colour scheme feels somewhere between pastel and grey. It takes what little visual intrigue there could be about any location in this game and reduces it to zero. How do you take a desert and make it more boring? God alive, Nier. Traipsing around, doing my side quests, and investing myself in this hefty open world, I marvelled at how boring it insisted on being. Like, every area is exaggerated reality enough that I can tell some thought went into making this game feel new and different, but it never hits the mark. It's like the bits between in a video game. For example, at the start of The Last of Us, when you leave Boston, just before you get into the two buildings that are leaning against each other, and you're just walking through these, like, nameless, featureless streets, that's how Nier's city feels. Like an in-between area. Honestly, that's how everything in Nier feels. Like, somewhere cool is right around the corner, but you never reach it.
And there are quite a lot of side quests. A lot of criticisms of this game have labelled the side quests as filler, but I don't think the term filler particularly applies to side quests, since filler to me is often something mandatory that you have to work through to continue on with, like, the main story. These side quests are very optional extras that you can embark on. Just, I think the issue with the side quests in this game is that the world you're in isn't interesting enough for you to want to play around in it and explore it. I don't care to trawl through the desert to pick up little rabbit droppings in the sand. I don't care to scour the city for materials. The locales are so bland that I feel like I've accidentally skipped out of bounds and I'm just running around in an outer area that lacks texture and substance.
What's more is that there are three stories in this game, and you've not really finished the game until you've done all three of them, since despite happening at the same time, they all feed into one another. Story A follows 2B, Story B follows 9S, her little twink companion, and Story C follows A2, a fugitive android who is on the run.
I saw a lot of people deflect criticism of Nier Automata because whichever reviewer they were referring to had played all three stories. So they would be like, I mean, if you didn't like the game, then why did you play it three times? But people who have actually played Nier Applebee's will understand that this is a really disingenuous argument to make.
Each character you play as has a different perspective, and while 9S has probably the least to offer of all of them, extra side quests he can embark on will highlight how the facility you work under, Yorha, is not being entirely honest with you. So he does have some value, and he contributes to the game's wider theme of being in a pointless cycle, so I don't entirely dislike his inclusion. But what I'm trying to finally get around to communicating here is the fact that the full story of this game features three playthroughs of Nier, all in the same areas, fighting the same enemies, killing the same bosses, backtracking for side quests until you've run through the same boring city, the same boring desert, the same boring forest, spared a quick sob as you've rushed through the same boring amusement park over and over and over again. I just felt like they could have done way more with this.
This one might be a bit of a hot take, but I do not care. I was once told that Nier was like anime Dark Souls, and I took that with a massive pinch of salt. Nowadays, anything with a combat focus, boss, checkpoint system is burdened with this label of being a Souls-like, or a Souls clone, or a Souls ripoff, and it exhausts me. However,
one new addition to Nier Autobahn that was distinctly different from Replicant was the new save system, a system that was implemented so half-arsedly that I had to triple check it even existed in the first place when I was writing this, or if it was just some terrible bad dream I had. So unlike normal games for normal people, there are two different kinds of saves in Nier Arse End of Nowhere, manual saves and autosaves. I understand that sounds okay at first, it sounds like the standard, but let me explain to you why it is so stupid that it left me genuinely confused. The game wants to be a linear combat-based game with thorough and consistent autosaves that permit a die-retry approach. And sometimes it is that game, with that combat. Only sometimes this combat will span a whole area, or like 30 minutes. So you definitely get into the habit of relying on the game to automatically save your progress throughout combat. Yet outside of combat, and in a few select situations, the game uses a hard save checkpoint system. You go up to the save machine, you click quick save, you make a hard save, and that manually your save slot. You die, you reload that hard save no matter how long ago it was, but you don't carry anything forward from before dying, so if you used all of your health potions and then died, you will not have them when you respawn. However, let's say you make a hard save and then you do 45 minutes of combat. During this segment, you die a few times and it resets autosaves throughout the combat, and then the combat ends, you walk on for a while, and you die here. Where do you think you respawn? Yes, you respawn at the hard save. The very first time I put this game down out of sheer annoyance, because I ended up putting it down 3 times during my ordeal with it, but kept coming back to it out of the sheer insistence of wanting to click with it and enjoy it, was during 2B's story, during a boss gauntlet that happens towards the end of her playthrough. I completed the gauntlet, then died, then realized all my autosaves were gone. I had to load a hard save, then I spawned all the way back at the base I had just left, only to have to do an entire boss gauntlet again. Only I died after the boss gauntlet, so my previous body and all of my stuff was not accessible to me until I had done this gauntlet. When I tried to leave the area to find a store or vendor I could buy some health boosters from, the game kept giving me one of its fucking endings, I'll get to those, and then booting me back. So I had to fight this boss again without my stuff.
This game has a really frustrating way of flipping back and forth between its own conventions. It can't make up its mind about what it wants to be. You rely on one save system and then it flips. Then you assimilate the new way into your playstyle and expectations, and you forget to make a hard save, and then it flips again, and you get sent back to your last hard save. I ended up having to constantly remind myself to be making hard saves, even in moments when autosaves were active. And a vast amount of my concentration ended up going into remembering to save at each opportunity. Because if, God forbid, I forgot and I relied on the autosaves in place throughout the combat that I kept reloading at, but would suddenly vanish as soon as I was out of the combat area. God forbid, if I was enjoying myself and getting into the swing of this game, I would be kicked back on my ass after 30 minutes because I had just done a 20-minute combat segment, walked into the next area, died, and my autosaves were gone. I was back at the last hard save. The constant back and forth also meant that I never got into the habit of returning to my previous body to collect my things, meaning that I was constantly operating on below optimal conditions. And the thing is, I was already not enjoying the game. I mean, I enjoyed the combat system, but I wasn't engaging with the mechanics in particular. So I imagine if you were really enjoying this game, you would more be able to facilitate this constant flux. But for me, I was already experiencing a lot of friction with the title, so this ended up just kicking me when I was down a lot of the times. Maybe if I was playing alone, I would have more of the mental capacity to keep tabs on this like dumpster fire. But I was streaming the game on Twitch since it was a gift. And as many of you will know, especially if you streamed on Twitch yourselves, you have to keep an eye on chat and be engaging with them and be talking to them. which means that like 30% of your brain is elsewhere and your focus isn't entirely on the game, which is, like I said before, my bad, that's fine. But man, making a save system 10 times more reliant on your concentration than it needs to be is a choice you are fully within your own rights to make when you're designing your game, but I am also fully in my rights to call it terrible because it was a dumb idea. I just found it stupid. Save mechanics are so intrinsic to games, and one of the things you need to do when building a save mechanic is just make it reliable, make it consistent. It can just be manual saves if you want. Like, I recently did Katamari Damacy, that's all manual saves. But as long as you know it's all manual saves, you can still operate on the assumption and the knowledge that it's manual saves. They're a fundamental need, not a want. They're a need that a user has to be able to save the game. And it was beyond annoying to have to remain extremely conscious of the game's mechanics because it put a barrier up between me and just being immersed in the game. You know, pick either or, Nia. If you want me to make hard saves, I'm happy to make hard saves. If you don't mind me relying on autosave checkpoints, that's cool too. But pick one. Stop messing me around. I hated this.
This is compounded during the tutorial. I know that this has been rehashed a load by a ton of different reviews, which is why it's here in this section as an afterthought, as even fans of the game agree that this is bad, but the tutorial can be anywhere up to an hour long depending on your adjustment to the game and its mechanics. But there are no save points, so if you die 40 minutes into your run through the tutorial, you fly right back to the start of the game, with no idea of how long you're expected to keep pushing through this one area before you are allowed to save. It could be a 3-hour gauntlet for all any new player is going to know.
This game felt so fundamentally spiteful about how it demanded it be played. I felt like it kept dangling player trust in my face, consistency, stuff I could rely on, and then just whipped it away whenever I reached for it. It felt cruel, whereas I felt it was more just stuck between having its usual autosave system and wanting to try something new and never being able to commit to either of them.
So, as I mentioned before, this game is structured into three different segments, 2B's story, 9S's story, and A2's story. If you rush through them, 2B will take you about 4 hours, I think, 9S will take you maybe 3, and A2 can take you about 6. I'm sure people have done it in more or less, but this is just a ballpark. And that's if you rush the main quests too. This game is littered with side quests, so if you sit and properly concentrate on getting all of that done, plus all the trophy requirements, you're looking at anywhere between, like, I'd say 40 and 60 hours. Again, it entirely depends on a and efficiency, but hey, you know, that's why I said ballpark.
Now, 9S's story is almost identical to 2B's, only with some extra lore and a different combat system. Thematically, having what is essentially a repeated playthrough is a great way to highlight the cyclical, trapped nature of the world they're in. The existentialism of living in the cycle of misery that needs to be broken. But in reality, it just ended up marking the second time I put this game down for what I thought was for good. See, sometimes things happen within the games mechanically because it makes sense in the story. And that can be a genuine excuse, and it can be a really effective way of pairing the story and the gameplay together. But sometimes it toes the line between what is reasonable versus what is a bit much. I do think this is a situation where, yeah, design-wise, it makes sense in the context. But as far as gameplay goes, this is one of the most miserable, wasteful decisions they could have made.
9S's segment isn't entirely panned. A few people like it. A lot of people hate his hacking minigames, but I actually really enjoyed them. Unfortunately, the fact is that it is an almost shot-for-shot remake of 2B's playthrough that the player literally just finished, complete with recycled cutscenes, which means it is a horrible, horrible drag. And yeah, you know, that maybe is the point, but that doesn't mean it isn't daft in its execution. Nia does do this meta-storytelling in some really interesting ways. For example, all of the different chips you have installed, you know, like the map chip or the OS chip, some of which can be deleted to save space for new, bigger, and more useful chips at the cost of crippling your navigational abilities. Sometimes mechanics and storytelling align really well, and Nia can do that. However, not with this. I finished 9S's story very slowly, having long since abandoned playing this on stream, because I was worried that having to maintain conversation with chat was preventing me from giving this game the best opportunity to show its quality. But man, this story is superfluous, and I feel like the fat could have been trimmed to make his arc something that felt more like a bridge between playthroughs screws, rather than the middle seat passenger taking up both the armrests. 9S's story concludes with a handover to a new android, an android you've seen periodically up until this point, A2, and so the story starts again, a third time. As I learned later, A2's segment is better than 9S's, but at that moment, the idea of replaying this whole story again, with a bitter taste in my mouth left by the ordeal of 9S, was so unsavoury that I couldn't face it. The game was shelved for another few months. This game shoots itself in the foot hard with 9S's section, no matter the thematic intention of dragging your ass through his midway point. But that's not only my gripe with the piss take that this game felt entitled to be.
My other issue with Nier Automata was the endings. This game very proudly touts itself as having 26 unique endings, one for each letter of the alphabet, and there's even a trophy for seeing every single one of them. So clearly somebody out there was proud of it enough to consider it a feat of engineering and storytelling. A few of these, as in maybe about five, I think less than five, are actual endings with actual cutscenes and actual dialogue and actual conclusions, but most of them are crappy fake endings, often in the form of a few lines of on-screen text, which explains how, exactly, the game has ended. I don't mind this as like a practical joke kind of thing, but for the game to often market itself on having 26 endings, I heard about the 26 endings long before I ever touched this game, implying a degree of consequence for each, and then to drop this is not so much insulting as it is just a bizarre design choice that ended up being flagrantly mismarketed. And I have two specific endings that wound me up so badly.
The first was ending, I think, L? I can't quite remember. But as I mentioned before during my save section, I had died after a boss near the resistance camp and could not physically retrieve my body and all of my stuff, rendering my attempt at the boss again to be quite hard. I thought, well, if I'm going to attempt this boss again, I'm going to need to buy some heals, having used all of them up during my prior fight. The resistance camp shop isn't open because, you know, why the fuck would it be? It's only my save spot before the boss fight. Why would they let me buy heals there? So I think, okay, sure, you know, let's be resourceful and go the extra mile to make sure we can actually do this boss fight. So I decided to go running off on the hunt for heals to see if I could find a shop nearby, and I suddenly got given an ending. 2B abandoned her duties and fled, the game said, and back to my last hard save I went, no heals in hand. The second was ending G, which I accidentally triggered after watching 9S's introductory cutscene. I landed on the factory map, starting playthrough 2. To my left, I had a brightly coloured horizontal crane reaching away from me that looked walkable. I couldn't see where else to go, not that I looked super hard since I assumed the crane was my next stop. I stepped onto it and immediately got the ending G, some on-screen text informing me that 9S had abandoned his duties and fled, and back to my last hard save I went. A lot of people consider these endings to be joke endings, but considering my rising vehemence for this title, it felt more like acts of spite than actual jokes, sending me back to saves from ages prior for the mistake of wanting to go and fetch supplies before I did a boss fight or exploring the environment. Bearing in mind I didn't have an opportunity to make hard saves as I began those chapters either, which I probably would have done before fetching resources if I was able to. I guess if I liked the game I would have taken these joke endings as jokes, but it's like getting an insult from a friend versus a stranger. I like my friend. I know our boundaries and our mutual respect. When they make fun of me, I laugh because there is an implicit understanding. When a stranger or someone I dislike makes fun of me, there's no mutual respect, so it's not something I can appreciate. That's how I would describe my relationship with this game as a whole, actually.
For those of you who know how much I hate annoying anime tropes, you'll probably agree that this deck was stacked against me from the beginning. No matter how much I really wanted to like this game, I was a huge Naruto fan as a teenager and never really branched out beyond mainstream anime. Bleach, D-Grayman, Death Note, occasionally I would dabble in things like Golden Boy, which on review have probably aged catastrophically poorly. But I struggle with anime purely because of, and I will willingly admit this, personal taste. I don't like hammy acting, I don't like the reliance on filler, I don't like when episodes are just flashbacks, i.e. scenes cut from previous episodes just relayed in sepia tone. I mean, I respect the resource limitations, but you know, it's sometimes these filler arcs can be like 40 episodes long. I don't like many of anime's more uncomfortable tropes, and that is unfortunately just how I am. It's just what I like and dislike. So when I saw the less extreme, darker, and slick black and white motifs of 2B's design, I suppose I expected something a little bit less cringe. And that's on me. I was wrong. Yeah, that's on me.
I guess my biggest issue with the game is 9S. On the whole, I do really like 2B as a character. She's dry without being condescending, and she's straightforward in her communications, which bypasses a lot of the verbose over-explaining that I typically find quite tiring about anime tropes. Also, she's a massive nerd and a stickler for the rules. 9S, to me, is just some strange, burly legal twink who runs around in a bizarre costume consisting of schoolboy shorts and a choker collar and knee-high socks. I think it's the shorts, personally. They de-age him. This man could be 30 for all I know, but his shorts make him look like he's just come in from a day on his bike. I think these overtly youthful but weirdly sexually aware tropes often fall on women, so listening to him try and deny the fact that he desperately wants to fuck 2B, getting strangely obsessed with her to the point of a weird hysteria, was an experience, but a well-implemented one. I think, actually, like, this is a good thing. I think it was a relationship dynamic that was demonstrated really well. It was clearly unhealthy, but made for a good story and was well-paced alongside the action. It's quite organic, too, starting with little things like trying to insist that she uses a nickname for him, despite her constant assertive no, but also telling her to stay and rest at the bunker, trying to spend more time with her despite not being required to continue working together as a partnership whatsoever. She's quite cold with him and hostile, and yeah, you know, there's some underlying stuff going on there, but he definitely never has affirmative responses from her. I think having a discomfort with a man's weird fixation on the main character we've spent so much time with is very well done. 9S's fixation is not played as healthy nor ideal. The game wields a lot of nuance in this department, which is a pleasant surprise when contrasted with a lot of particularly abundant trashy anime tropes that would normally play this dynamic as attractive, cute, or even healthy. I guess my difficulty is in reconciling this with the fact that he looks and acts like a 12-year-old. Beyond this, I didn't especially like his presence in the game at all. My compliments to Pod and 2B aside, I realized quite quickly that Pod was only a red herring on the whole subverting the exposition trope, since 9S then nicely slotted in and started talking my ear off for the next 10 hours. 9S is more or less a blank slate until he embarks on his own story. So for the first playthrough, he is just someone to bounce exposition off. Things like emotions are prohibited, which 2B snaps whenever he shows any emotion whatsoever. In fact, the character's obsession with emotion was not especially well done. Emotions are prohibited definitely ranks in the top percentile of any interaction any of the cast have amongst each other, especially with 2B at the helm, which struck me as an unusual in-universe grievance to have, considering they could just not teach the androids emotion. When we teach AI, we give it a set of rules. That's all AI is, really. It's not self-aware, especially by our standards of today. It's just a set of rules. Like the AI that supposedly pilots self-driving cars. You know those captures you do where you have to select the boxes with the traffic lights? That's data that gets fed into a huge database for self-driving AI. And the rule is it a traffic light or is it not a traffic light? And if it is a traffic light, you know, how do we proceed? To teach an AI emotion, not only would you have to teach it those rules, but then you also have to give it instances where those rules can be broken or ignored based on an AI's personal preferences or motivations. Does it matter that it's a traffic light? My friend is in danger, maybe I drive past it despite the colour. Or maybe I'm scared of something and I ignore the traffic light, maybe I see it's on amber and I want to rush through it quickly. And at that point, you'd have to teach them what a personal preference is and what a personal motivation is, and why would you do that if you didn't want them to have emotion? And it's harder to teach an AI emotion than it is to teach it logic, so why did you give them emotions and then ban them? I don't understand, it's arbitrary.
It's a huge plot hole that largely goes nowhere as far as I observed, and at the same time sits at the forefront of so many characters' conversations without ever finding resolution. And the more they bang on about it, the more I'm like, why did you teach an AI to feel grief if you don't want it to feel grief? Why did you specifically set up a framework in their minds and teach them with thousands and thousands of pieces of, like, input data to respond to horrible events with, like, deep emotional pain? Who did this? Like, whose idea was this?
It always ends like this.
The ban on emotion doesn't really work, anyway. The androids all exhibit a wide and consistent variety of emotions: grief, relief, curiosity, happiness, anger. Not just basic primary colour emotions, there's a lot of complexity on display. 2B seems to be the only one who follows the rule to any extent, which leads me to believe she just made it up or found it in the ancient company handbook, and everyone else around her just tolerates her because they don't like getting a lecture, like she's some strange android evangelist. Most of the androids experience emotions. The androids android that speaks to you from the bunker giggles when she talks to you, and at one point gets rejected by an android she has feelings for, and cries very loudly to you for a few minutes. It's a lot. Less than an hour into the game, 9S very dramatically dies. After you beat the prologue boss as 2B, very capably over the course of about, like, I don't know, 10 minutes, she stops and stares at the dying boss as it does this very blatant overhead swing. The same overhead swing it's been doing since the fight started and you've been easily dodging. I don't know why this is the cutscene attack that blows 2B away, but whatever. Anyway, 9S takes the shot instead and dies melodramatically. He gets his leg and arm blown off, but by the time you get to him and kneel beside him, he's like coughing and slowly dying. It's a hilarious scene. She's known him for less than an hour as well. And then 2B is utterly distraught and extremely upset. You know, there's lots of emotion. I don't know, it bothers me. Why are we writing this big story about what it means to be human with all these weird contradictory contextual laws that the game fixates on but never does anything with? And why is he wearing those fucking shorts?
This brings me on to my penultimate criticism, and this is a general criticism I've seen amongst other people who did not particularly like this game. That being said, to be clear and upfront, I don't know loads about philosophy. But according to many fans of the series, this is a good thing. Apparently, the concepts found in these games aren't especially novel, so if you're well versed in philosophy, you won't find this groundbreaking or interesting. Like, on my end of things, I am aware of what philosophy is, and I am interested to hear about it, but not so involved in it that I've heard it all before. Even so,
I think the issue with this game is that it can't quite decide whether to leave breadcrumbs for you or just to tell you straight to your face what it's about. Many of the bosses and characters are named after big-time philosophers, but beyond that, their relevance to the story is at best referential and at worst an exercise in auto-fellatio. There's never quite a reveal in this game that you've not already either guessed or just been straight out told well in advance, but the game seems to think that it's being subtle about all of them. Namely, that robots are sentient. We're told early on that humans are hiding from the robot enemies on the moon, but later we find out that humans aren't on the moon, they've been dead the whole time. We're told that the robots were introduced by aliens. Turns out that the aliens were a red herring, created to give robots and androids a reason to fight, because giving someone an enemy gives them a reason to keep going, and the androids need something to do so long after the humans are dead. The monologuing villain we meet 2 hours in isn't actually the villain, etc, etc. The game gives us facts, we accept them as true, and then later on the game will show us a subversion of them as if it's a reveal, when in reality we already knew that and now we're just confused. By the time we get to the desert, we're fighting robots who are going, "I'm scared," and "Go away, please," as we kill them. And 9S goes, "Do you think they understand the concept of being scared?" and points out that they wear clothes. It's not 2 hours in when you walk into a room with a robot rocking her baby in a cot, and other robots telling each other that they love each other, and you murder them all and they act in self-defense, and you're like, "Is this game going to seriously drag this 'what does it mean to be alive' plot point out for the whole game?" Spoiler alert, yes. The characters constantly recognize it too, and they constantly discuss it. 9S will go, "Hey 2B, why do these machines do this thing or think this way?" And 2B will go, "Emotions are forbidden." And 9S will go, "You're right, I suppose we will have to kill it now." The machine goes, "Oh, please don't kill me, I'm alive, I feel, I have children, no, my family." And 9S goes, "Wow 2B, are we really better than these machines?" 2B will tell him to stop talking and 9S will apologize. These conversations are recycled ad nauseam. Before we've even left the desert during our first few story beats, we figure out that the robots are alive. We meet Adam, and Eve is born from his rib, like, within the first 2 hours, and try to kill them on sight. If I could change the structure of the game, I would have vastly changed the first playthrough and removed all of the time spent meeting and helping friendly robots, instead focusing more on Yorha, the organization that is lying to 2B. I wouldn't have so much of an emphasis from the get-go on robots being sentient, because it destroys any potential build-up to difficult realizations.
I would have had 2B's storyline just as blinkered as she is. 2B is fixated on rules and following orders, so I think her being in some kind of denial that permeates the entire playthrough would have been really interesting. 9S asks why the robots could be wearing clothes, and she dismisses him by snapping back at him, that there's no point trying to work out unsolvable problems. She's very actively ignorant. She is determined to stay ignorant and just do her job. I think her attitude would have worked a lot better in, like, more of a rose-tinted playthrough. Maybe literally with a chip that can be deleted, like the map chip and stuff like that can be deleted, that garbles robot speech so that she can't hear what they're saying, or even adds UI additions that actively blurs or pixelates aspects of a robot's life to make it easier for her to, like, dehumanize them and kill them. You know, have her storyline be about setting up assumptions, murdering robots, and laying the groundwork for how the story develops in the next two playthroughs.
In my opinion, have 9S's story begin to show the cracks, and then feature our big reveals in A2's storyline. Like, when the story should be ending? There is a little bit of this in the game, but more in the case that 2B can't see that the bosses are named after philosophers. The names above their health bars just show up as symbols to her, whereas 9S can. But that doesn't add anything to our understanding of the current situation. It's just a reveal that they have names. I don't know. As it stands, the game is so proud of itself for all of these ideas that it can't help but beat us over the head with the inevitable twist from the first minute, meaning that most of the reveals fall completely flat, because they aren't reveals at all. Even the narrative twists are fairly nah. There's a robot called Pascal who is marked for death from the start, because they're super nice and they have that little baby voice so many Mo anime characters have, which basically tells me that they are so innocent that they will be used as the emotional crescendo of the game. But they're also so insipidly frictionless that I'll be honest, I was just not feeling it. Sorry, Pascal. Nia ends up retreading a lot of the surface level philosophical observations so many other games and TV have done for a long time before and since. Signalis, Soma, Spec Ops The Line, Annihilation, Donnie Darko, The Matrix, Westworld, etc. But it never indulges in anything beyond surface level acknowledgements. Any discussion this game tries to raise, and it does try to raise a significant amount of discussion, ends up being so shallow that it draws attention to how bare bones the narrative reveals actually feel. Nier Automotive's story is heavily focused on themes of existentialism. That is to say, the pointlessness of everything the characters and the machines do, and their constant unending cycle, to the point where it's referenced in the first spoken line. This is the meta justification for why the game has three playthroughs before you even see the true ending. Yet, I think with the issues of pacing out the narrative beats and how desperate the game is to bombard you with breadcrumbs that are more like paddles to the cheek, these themes aren't explored to their fullest potential, and they really could have been explored in far more interesting ways. Nier Achy Breaky Heart ends up building this feeling of smug gravitas that isn't really earned, especially with the ending that involves the option to delete all of your saved data. Yes, when the game ends for the final time, ending E, you will be faced with the option to wipe your saved data clean entirely.
People tend to tout this as some big meta commentary on the cyclical nature of how games portray human conflict and also human conflict in the real world. Like, this is some massive sacrifice that you make for the good of the world. But first of all, this choice is given to you at the end of the game. So unless you plan to replay it, which, yeah, some of you may, but some of you also will not, it's not exactly a loss. But secondly, this happens in basically every single game made by Yoko Taro. The man has an MO for sure, losing permanent progress, bringing up concepts as a minigame with a twist, having you fight teammates in the finale, but his is a major one.
The game got a lot of praise for this, and it's like, I think sacrificing your progress would be more effective if you had the option to do it at the 11th hour. You know, make the good choice for the in-game world and sacrifice yourself and everything you have, technically the morally good ending, right at the tipping point, or make the selfish choice as the player because you want to see the rest of the game, thereby dooming the world because you want the content. I just think this design choice gets much more credence than it deserves. Your average player will likely only play most story games once, so it's hardly a sacrifice. There's definitely the air of a man who huffs his own farts here. Yeah, you know, that's rude of me to say, but whatever, you can say it about me too if you want. But there's a lot of people cooing over this apparent genius and creative visionary, and then I look over at him and he's just some slimy little man who implemented an upskirt mechanic in a game whilst living in the country with an upskirt issue so extreme that it is the reason the shutter sound on phones cannot be muted. I'll discuss this more in detail later, but every shot of 2B is carefully angled so that you can see up her skirt. It is bizarre to me to have a man spoken about with such collective reverence when he gives me the vibes of a wheezing individual that loudly masturbates on the backseat of a city bus. I feel like Nier Archbishop was touted to me as a game that would change the way I thought about the world, and ended up being a very derivative, shallow attempt at covering philosophy in a way so many other games and films have covered so much better and so much more thoroughly. Whilst the creator is just sat on a sofa in the corner of the room trying to see if he can wedge his penis between the cushions. I've never prescribed background reading before in my entire YouTube existence, except maybe Hellstar Remina, but that doesn't count because I say so. So I will offer a summary here if you can't be bothered to go and check out what I'm about to suggest, but Dan Olsen from Folding Ideas, actually one of my biggest inspirations, hello Dan if you ever see this, but you probably won't, once made a video titled The Thermian Argument. For those of you who have already seen it, yeah, you know where I'm going. For those of you that haven't, it's worth a look. It's about 5 minutes long and it will put into words a lot of my logic when approaching this section of the video and give you a bit of context as to how the Thermian argument can be applied to all kinds of media. But for those of you that don't want to watch it, it can be summarized as such. The Thermian argument involves two steps. We will use Miss Kobayashi's Dragon Maid as an example. Step one, someone criticizes a piece of fiction, usually for problematic themes. In our example, we will cite the fact that this animation features many scenes involving children in sexual situations, with the explicit intent on being titillating for the audience. Step two, fans of the work defend it using an in-universe piece of context. In this instance, the character Kana Kamui only looks, acts, and dresses like a 9-year-old. She is actually 300 years old, and she is a very powerful dragon. So according to the in-universe context, Kana Kamui is not technically a child, and therefore there is nothing wrong with her rubbing herself on other characters in a way that specifically arouses them and is framed in a way so as to be arousing to the audience. So you see, with in-universe context, it is not the illicit, disgusting depiction that you, a non-fan, would see it as. 2B, despite the things I like about her, remains somehow just an insult. She's like a creepy little fleshlight. I think the line of where female characters becomes gross is when they're designed to be sexy through the lens of what a man expects from a sexualized character. It's like the idea of a trophy wife, women who are prized based on what a guy assumes other men will find attractive and will therefore covet. If you want to design a character you think other people will be attracted to, you will imbue a trait you believe other people find attractive. I guess where it started to grow tired is just in the sheer volume of these honeypot characters in gaming. What I'm trying to say is, just tell us you like arse, guys. Just tell us you like sexy women and steering up their skirts. Just tell us you like it when their clothes fly off randomly. Look, Yoko, I completely respect your openness about liking sexy women and incorporating them into your game, because you like looking at sexy women. A lot of people insist that 2B
and Kaine from Replicant
are sexy because the game is trying to make a statement about the over-sexualization of characters in gaming. It's clearly being tongue-in-cheek. They're mocking the tropes by playing them completely straight, which, if you can't tell by my tone, is something I regard as the center of a Venn diagram between delusion, denial, and wishful thinking. I think more people need to be honest about why they put big titty women in bikinis and have them flop around on screen. Oh, Quiet breathe through her skin. Just say you want tits in your face, Kojima. I'd respect you more for it. Just own it, you fucking child. Sexy 2B is fine. However, sexy 2B, because it's actually within the lore that she's sexy, is cringe. Grow up. This game, through its thin veneer of good writing and pretending to paddle in the shallows of philosophical discussion, is essentially just a big stare at her ass simulator. The game is absolutely desperate for you to stare up 2B's skirt. As you're walking around the world, the camera always pulls itself slowly back and points upwards slightly, angling from below up into 2B's skirt so that you see constant slips of her bum. I had to hold the analog stick very precariously the entire time so that I wasn't spending my playtime wedged between her enormous pillowy ass cheeks. I mean, I love a bum, I'm a widow main after all, but there's something so intrinsically creepy about how the game constantly frames 2B. I feel like it sat next to me throughout my entire playthrough, a hand on my shoulder and a voice in my ear going, hey, let's look up her skirt, shall we? No one will judge us, she won't mind. Let's get her in a nice ladder or something and take a little peek. Oh look, you can see it just a little bit there. Just with the way the camera snakes backwards. Wow, that's a nice bum, isn't it? Imagine being inside that. Isn't it hot? Isn't it sexy? This weird voyeurism sits around 2B like an audience of screaming, jeering men. I feel like that one scene from A Requiem for a Dream, you know, the one right at the end. Yeah, you know the one. She feels isolated almost, on a pedestal. I feel uncomfortable for her. And I have never felt like that with another gaming character in my life. This is a very novel feeling I feel for 2B. Oh, don't worry about her fat dumpy and her miniskirt, the game slithers in my ear. It's because she's an android. She's a combat unit. She produces heat when she moves, and she vents that heat out of her bum. That's why it needs to be bare, because it'll catch fire otherwise. And that's why it has such a large surface area. To add to this, there's even an animation 2B does if you stare up her skirt, specifically in the instance that you very carefully go to look at her bum. She'll give you a few seconds to look and then coyly step away, an acknowledgement of you being a little bit cheeky, but no real consequence. Not only that, but using the self-destruct option causes a huge AOE AoE explosion, which can be useful, but more serves as a way to remove 2B's skirt, which is for some reason the only item on her body that's vulnerable to blast. So after that, she'll run around with her ass entirely out, except when you self-destruct 9S, and he's still wearing shorts. The game knows and encourages constant creepy voyeurism. It gives you a wink and a little tap on the back of your hand when you do it, like you're a naughty little boy who doesn't know any better, because she's an android and emotions are prohibited, but she's still a fully anatomically correct woman with all the required bits and pieces for no explainable reason. Except because she's an android, she's also completely clean and sterile. No pee, no poop, no sweat, none of the normal trimmings that come with yucky women. This is a sex doll with emotions. No real motivations though, nothing beyond following orders from her human owners. So she's loyal and she will do whatever you tell her to, and would never stand up for herself nor complain, don't worry. With just enough emotion that you can kid yourself that she'd like you, but no, don't worry, she's loyal enough to you to reassure you that you're not going to have to compete with anybody else who might be nicer or have a higher standard of personal hygiene. Everything about 2B is just the Thermian argument incarnate. She has been so explicitly designed for the activation of neurons in monkey brains. Sexy lady, big bum. Yes, sexy lady. Awesome bum. Show me the bum now, please. I think the weird thing about creating as much in-universe justification as possible for small details like a fat ass is that it starts to draw attention to other things. Why does she have to wear that outfit then? And why does she do stupid belly flops every time she jumps? Why does her dress have such a massive slit in it that even in cutscenes it just fully opens at the front so you can see her white pants at the slightest gust of wind? Just a face full of vag. Does she know or care? There's just something about her that is so explicitly common denominator that she's kind of insulting. Like throwing a steak to a dog and watching it lose control over it. There's something so abundantly animal about how 2B is framed. I love her design at face value, I really do. It was the thing that drew me into playing this game for the first time, but playing it on stream and just having these constant explanations for the in-universe reasoning as to why she needs to have a fat ass or why she needs to have her skirt blow off when she's self-destructing but the 9S doesn't, she feels kind of patronizing. I don't know. I have never felt this with any other gaming character. I appreciate that characters can be eye candy and I do encourage it. Drawing hot characters is awesome, but there was something so desperate about the way 2B was designed and depicted that I felt seedy even looking at her. When A2 appeared and I asked why she was wearing lingerie and someone said, actually, no, she's not wearing lingerie. Her outer shell is falling away in pieces. It just happens to be in the shape of lingerie. By the way, you're only about halfway through the game. I was like, yeah, no, I've had enough. And down the game went again.
I did eventually finish dragging myself through Nier Automata, but I hated it so much. I think it's best to finish a game in its entirety before you try critiquing it. Like, imagine if I tried to critique this game based on the first 2 hours, it would be so easy to debunk and laugh off. And, you know, while I'm sure you were puzzled as to why I insisted on finishing it, if I hated it that much, I'm sure you can also appreciate the fact that I wanted to give this game the benefit of the doubt and have an informed opinion. There have been so many games that I have enjoyed so much more on a second playthrough, so I thought Nier Automata would fall into this category, and unfortunately I was wrong, you know. But thanks for watching, thanks for being here. Feel free to drop a like if you enjoyed it, a comment perhaps, maybe some recommendations on games you thought approached these tropes and mechanics a lot better. You know, I'm always down for those. My own recommendation is coming up in the next 30 seconds. A huge thank you again to PIA for sponsoring this video. Make sure to check them out again in the description link and the pinned comment. And make sure to check out my Patreon for those sweet extra rewards and little bits of content. In conclusion, if you want a dark dystopian sci-fi game with hot anime characters, a theme of futility, fighting cycles over and over again, for something that will always be denied to you in the form that you want it, the difficult consideration of what makes a person a human, and an examination of all sorts of awesome themes, play Signalis instead. That game is amazing. And the great thing about Signalis is you only have to play it once.